One, two.
When it's the end of the weekend, but not quite the end of the weekend. Check it out. It is what it is. You got me feeling.
You make me feel like I'm in all my best clothes. So good that I don't care the Chick-fil-A's closed. Like a slow motion cruise on the back roads and byways. Windows down and I'm boarding the highways. Nah. We got lots of time, that seems like a good investment. It's the end of the week and I make a mean quiche. Maybe all of our friends should come over to eat.
Nah.
Welcome to New Life, people becoming the church, wherever you're watching around the world. I mean, one of the things that's so fun, isn't it great to know you're a part of something bigger than yourself? You're not just tuning in. You're not just consuming. You're engaging with the church all Nice. Over the world. And what's beautiful is the church throughout history and time. And that's this. And we, the heart of why we do this and why we invest in it and why you honestly, you give to this is so that you can see the church spreading everywhere. So from St. Louis to Guatemala to London to right here in Seattle, we're so thankful you are listening, you're feeding a baby, you're at the gym, you're watching, you got people with you, however it's happening, we're so thankful you're here. A couple of things before we dive in. So we're in a series, Love Where You Live. So I just believe this is for our church more than a series. So like, what does that mean? Well, campaign might be a close word, but I actually think this is gonna be our heartbeat for the next 10 years. So a couple ways that I think you can engage while we're having this message this morning or wherever you're watching is if you go to newlife.tv/loveyourlive. So there's gonna be some resources there. One of the things you'll see is a map. So the map is beautiful vision because it's gonna connect us to each other. I mean, you can just imagine as you scroll that map back, seeing a flood of people who are saying, I love where they live. One of the stories I heard this week is someone said, hey, there's someone in my neighborhood I didn't know yet. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that they loved it. I saw the pin, I thought, I wanna get to know that person. Wouldn't it be beautiful if you had neighbors you didn't even know and you were sharing a vision of loving where you live? The other thing you'll see there is a PDF. So this PDF, it's a workbook. It's probably the type of workbook that like, you're gonna wanna start and do 40% by yourself. Like you're gonna get some time with God, you're gonna sit and you're gonna write some things. But it's gonna work, the magic of it is you're gonna sit with friends, family, your spouse, your kids, coworkers, and you're gonna start to look at this together. I think this is a beautiful, it's a kind of a vision cast for your life of how you love where you live. So you'll see the PDF there. If you're like, I don't wanna print it. I like the one you have in your hand. So I will send this to you. You just like put it in the chat. I've done it. A lot of you know, like I will send you something. So you're like, Brian, please send, I got it. I'll send it in the mail. If you're local, you're like, I wanna pick it up. Great, like I'd love for you to have this. So however you get this, I think it's that important. And it might be the type of thing you're gonna set up on one of the screens, you're gonna look through as we're diving in today. So with that, we're in a story of Nehemiah. It's really a journal, and we're looking at how we love where we live. So, Wes, I just start with Nehemiah.
Okay.
Give us like what is the Nehemiah in 1 minute or less?
Okay. Okay. So, all right. Well. Okay. So Nehemiah is the cupbearer. So he's an assistant mm-hmm. to the king of Persia, mm-hmm. which was the largest empire of the time. And Nehemiah is Jewish, and so his like. Great-great-grandparents would have been people who grew up in Jerusalem. And so that city is dear to his heart. That nation had been actually now really no longer exists, and the people have been distributed to the surrounding area. He gets word back that the city that he thought was being rebuilt because people had gone back home, that actually the city was not being rebuilt. It actually was... It's damaged, it's destroyed, and people were, they're kind of giving up on the city. And so he hears this, and then for some time, his heart's heavy. And there's a day where he actually has a conversation with the king, and the king's like, hey, how can I help you? And he ends up getting sent to Jerusalem with all the resources and with vision to gather the people to rebuild a city. Getting everybody to find their place on a wall and to help rebuild that. And the people do in 52 days what had not been done in 141 years. They rebuild the city of Jerusalem. In a lot of ways, what's happening is it's not just rebuilding the city, it's rebuilding their relationships and rebuilding their relationship with God.
It's crazy. I had a friend this week and he's like, I'm sitting down. So I've got a group that's meeting, and they're like a lot of people who aren't a part of the church, which by the way, that's like why this church started. It's like people who are like, I don't have a church anymore.
Yeah.
There was some people in the group that are like, I've been in church a long time. They're like, I've never read Nehemiah. And you're just like, so this is an opportunity for us to really look at, it's not more than a book, it's a journal. We'll get to that.
Yeah, yeah.
But give us some stuff that's like, you just know in your heart and your head about Nehemiah or about the story that's like, some Bible nerd stuff. Some stuff that you're like, I know you have it, so sure. Like that's what I want.
Well, I mean, every story has a context. And so if you just look at just that one part of the story, you can dive in deeply, and that's helpful. But sometimes it's good to go at 30,000 feet and look down and see what surrounds it.
Yeah.
And so there's key dates in American history, like 1776 is the Declaration of Independence.
Yeah, Declaration of Independence.
Yeah. Okay, so we have key dates. So for the Jewish people, 586 is a key date because it was the destruction of Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. So the Babylonians came in and they destroyed the temple, destroyed the city, burned it, and took people into, it was the third wave of exiles that were taken away in the final. Now, okay, Babylon ends up being taken over by Persia. And so you go from King Nebuchadnezzar all the way down now to where you get Persia would be Cyrus, okay? Mm-hmm. And Cyrus decrees for the Jews to go back home. Mm-hmm. So 50,000 Jews go to Jerusalem to rebuild. And it's interesting, is you know what, they go at first like, we're just gonna rebuild the city, we're gonna rebuild the temple, we're gonna our worship of God, we're gonna like, but they actually get kind of sidetracked, like they get the temple halfway done, and then everyone just starts to build their own homes. And if I see you building your home, why am I going to the temple?
Keeping up with the Joneses. Yeah, right? You're like, I got to do that too.
So it's like, my house is fine, but we'll complain about the city.
Wow.
Okay, so along the way, what happens is prophets, you have like Zechariah or Haggai, begin to call the people to join Zerubbabel in the finishing of the temple. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the temple then gets finished. Mm-hmm. So they do, and it's not as glorious as it was under Solomon, right?
Yeah.
So, okay, but they're like, we have a temple now.
Yeah.
Okay. The people, their worship, actually, it was more than that the building of the temple needed to be rebuilt. The people's worship needed to be rebuilt. So under Ezra, you have the reform of worship.
The call back.
The reform of the temple. Yeah. So now Ezra and Nehemiah is originally one book. Mm-hmm. Okay. So Ezra, the priest, grabs Nehemiah's journal. And he's like, this is the stuff. Yeah, this is the stuff. And so, so we have the reform of the temple in Ezra. You then have with Nehemiah the rebuilding of the city. Hmm. Now, this interesting thing is Nehemiah is actually serving a king by the name of Artaxerxes. Hmm. And Artaxerxes' dad, Xerxes, I don't know if that's how you name people. Xerxes, he actually was killed by one of the core members of his court. Hmm. And by the way, if you want to just know trivia, I mean, Xerxes shows up in the book of Esther. Mm-hmm. So when Esther wins the beauty contest to become queen. Mm-hmm. She ends up saving the Jews. And you know, perhaps you were born for such a time as this, that moment.
Yeah.
Okay. So Esther is about, let's call this like 20 years before Ezra, which is about 20 years before Nehemiah.
Okay. But there's the overlap. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So Artaxerxes has to be hyper focused on who his inner core is.
Yeah. Yeah.
My dad was killed by one of them, right?
Yeah. It's not worth my time not paying attention to it.
So you can imagine the trust that Nehemiah would have.
Okay? Wow.
So now there is going to be some stories that come after this. So Malachi, the last book in the Old Testament, is a prophet that is actually calling people again to, they now have the cities rebuilt, their homes are built, the temple's rebuilt, but people start to like, honestly, start to, their worship becomes like, what's the least amount that I can give to God and still feel like—
Check the box.
Yeah, people think I'm righteous.
Wow.
So all of those books kind of form this story. And then you have 1st and 2nd Chronicles, mm-hmm. which is basically 1st and 2nd Kings retold 500 years later to a whole new group of people. But that gives you some context to what's happening.
Yeah.
Nehemiah is this storyline, not about the people's homes or the temple, but about the rebuilding of the city. Mm. And one of the things I've been noticing, Brian, I feel like God has really been convicting me. It's interesting because I feel like God's speaking this to me, but I'm talking to others and like he's saying it to me too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I don't think that God's asking pastors to have vision for their churches. Mm-hmm. I think Jesus is saying, I got that covered. Mm-hmm. I think he's asking churches to have vision for their communities and cities. Have we been building towers to the sky?
Yeah, or our own homes and forgotten about the wasteland around us.
Yeah, so God has put us here to love where we live. We're here for actually the flourishing of a garden city. Yeah. Isn't that where it is?
Yeah.
So that's some backstory.
What's great? You live somewhere. You're like, I live here. So wherever we live, I mean, one of the things that's been challenging me. So that like last week, you missed it. You're like, I don't know. So it's worth going back. So Jenny kind of kicked off the series, giving us a ton of just kind of context for our hearts and getting ourselves centered. And one of the things that like challenged me was I just have a positive attitude, and I tend to be a little bit more optimistic, which is like, that's a good thing. Well, so it can also be a negative thing. So it's hard for me to drive around my city and, you're like, love where you live. I'm like, great, let's do it. So you see in Nehemiah that he actually has to let his heart break. There's an emotion. So some of us, it's harder to go there. Others of us, maybe we've gone so far there that's like God's pulling us into a vision of the future that could be better. Okay. So next week, by the way, what we're going to hear is there's going to be a beautiful message on how we actually collect teammates. Okay. But I think as we look at that, one of the things that I think is interesting is this whole idea of a journal.
Okay.
So just this, like, he writes a journal.
Sure.
I don't journal, but I think I should. I should start out this series.
Nehemiah is a guy.
Yes.
He has a job in a journal.
Yeah,
that's a good way to say it. What if everybody who had a job also had a journal?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I've been talking to people, and they're like, do you have a job? They're like, yes. Do you have a journal? I don't keep a journal.
Yeah.
They're like, do you keep a journal? I'm like, I don't, but I have before.
Yeah, and I've bought quite a few. Like, I have a stack of them that I should start.
Yeah. And so I was talking to one guy, and he's like, I'm not going to journal. He's like, I'm not going to journal.
Yeah.
And I said to him this. I said, do you think you'll write a book one day? And he said, yeah.
Hmm.
I said, what if God showed up to you today and said, listen, that book you're going to write, it's going to be the stuff that happens this next 3 months. Would you keep a journal now?
Wow. That's a good question.
And I said this, I wonder if the reason why we don't keep a journal is we don't think we're living a life that's a story worth telling.
Hmm. That's really powerful.
And so one of my hearts is that what if we get everybody in these next, let's just call it 3 months, keep a journal. Hmm. And see, I just think when we do that, is there's like almost like a faith element of God, I think you're going to do something. So what I did is I wanted to see if there's a mental health aspect to keeping a journal.
Correlation, okay.
Yeah, because Nehemiah kept the journal, it became a book. But I was wondering, I don't think that's why he kept, I don't think Nehemiah's like, you know what, I'm going to write a book one day.
Yeah. This will probably be a book people read thousands of years from now. Yeah. No.
I think he's like, this is going to be hard. There's going to be difficulty, opposition. Have we gone through anything hard the last couple of years? I think he's like, this is going to keep me sane. I'm going to need to write stuff down to stay emotionally and mentally healthy. So, okay. So I did some research.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
On journals.
Yeah. So I went online and I said, okay, where would be the best, most respected, website to really see about the mental health benefits of journaling? So I went to WebMD.
As I would.
WebMD, which, you know, you can knock it, but isn't that where you go when you don't want to pay your copay? I think so. So I went on there. Here's the five benefits of journaling. Okay, the first one they say is this is reduces anxiety.
Hmm.
Okay, do we have any anxiety issues?
Yeah.
Okay, now that tends to be about the future.
Fear and worry, yeah.
Okay. It also does this, it helps with brooding.
Okay, so pent up.
Brooding, I didn't even know what brooding was.
Yeah.
It says it's obsessively thinking over what's happened in the past.
Wow.
So this helped me with my future.
Yeah.
This helped me with my past.
Wow.
Number three, regulates emotions, evens you out.
Do we have a culture right now that's maybe journaling on Facebook that should be journaling behind the scenes? But right? So evens you out. You're like, I'm a little bit less of this and a little bit more.
So it helps with my future. It helps with my past. Helps with my present. Number four. It actually encourages opening up and emotional healing.
Hmm.
So if I journal, it's going to help me do what in my relationships?
Well, probably be open and empathetic. And then
I will receive support.
Empathy, support, community.
Yeah, maybe the reason why we don't have community is we don't even know how to open up.
Wow.
And if you think about this, journaling in some ways is also teaching you how to pray.
Hmm.
Because you're opening up to God now.
Okay? No, that's true. And you watch Nehemiah, some of what he's writing sounds like a prayer, but also it's like emotional. Like he's saying things, you're like, can you say it? Yeah. Yes. So he puts it into words. That's really powerful. Okay, so the last one.
Last one is that it speeds up physical healing. No way. Yeah.
I roll my ankle.
Yeah.
Journaling may help me heal quicker.
You'd have at least a mental and emotional health support. And so apparently that makes a difference physically.
That's huge.
Yeah. Uh-huh. I did more research.
Okay. Keep going.
Okay. So then I went online. So I went to New York Times and they had a lead article. And this is the headlines. It's Life or Death, the Mental Health Crisis Among U.S. Teens.
Hmm.
So right now, the biggest crisis in America is the mental health of teenagers.
Wow.
Well, think about that.
Yeah, the biggest crisis.
I mean, these are where the walls are broken in our nation.
Yeah.
And so going through and looking at that, because I think we have a lot of people right now self-diagnosing on TikTok.
That's good. That's true. That's good.
And anxiety is real.
Yep.
Anxiety is real. Okay, but I was reading through the article, and it's like going, okay, it's like I'm always looking for like what helps.
Yeah.
And they said the number one thing that helps a teenager is to be able to sit down and have a safe conversation with a caring adult.
Hmm.
We just had this idea, Brian. What if, because we already have a structure.
We have youth.
Youth active. Leaders.
Yep, youth everywhere. Leaders. Yep.
Yeah. What if we gave them each $20 and said, look, would you sit down this month with four teenagers? Mm-hmm. Have, you know, give them a, I don't know what they have. Is it a cup of coffee? They don't drink
cappuccino. I don't. Yeah, yeah.
Something.
Ice cream. Slurpee. Bowl. Yeah, Slurpees. That felt good. I don't know. Slurpee. Yeah, but Slurpee. Whatever. Okay. Yeah. You got the cash for it.
Okay, but you sit down.
Yeah.
Have a conversation and listen to them.
Yeah.
And there's something about creating the space with a caring adult, where because what happens is when they start to share and open up, they're actually going to start to get healthier.
Yeah, you're modeling a sense of almost journal, like you're letting this somebody is, verbal process as if
journaling.
They were journaling.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then usually there's something that they need to hear back.
Hmm.
And that is this. They need to hear back. It's going to get better.
Yeah.
Because most of the teens are like, I only have this much perspective in life and I haven't had as many ups and downs. I just think this is the rest of my life.
Yeah, highly isolated.
But I mean, if you just look physiologically, your brain's not even fully formed.
No, your frontal lobe is still pretty,
mushy. Yeah, so I think for Nehemiah, not only does this become a book, but this actually, the journal helps him become the leader that God made him to be. And I think that journal's gonna help you.
Yeah, so last week we really looked at the beginning of the story where Nehemiah is kind of emotionally allowing himself to feel it and then paused there. So as we dive in here, what do you see, what do we read, and then what's the stuff that's like, it's gonna help us grow in that area.
I don't know, do we dive in? Can we read it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So I'm here in chapter 2. It says, early the following spring in the month of Nisan, during the 20th year of King Artaxerxes' reign, I was serving the king as wine. So this is Nehemiah.
Hmm.
And I'd never before appeared sad in his presence, which when you serve like a king, you don't want to bring your personal stuff.
Yeah.
I'd say it's a good rule for work, period.
Yeah.
Okay. So the king asked me, why are you looking so sad? You don't look sick to me. You must be deeply troubled. So Nehemiah's normal is not to walk around and be pouting.
Mm-hmm.
He's probably an upbeat, positive person, but he has a heavy heart, so it's noticeable.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're like pouting all the time, nobody notices when you have a heavy heart.
Yep. But if you've been the type of leader who's engaged with the king at a high level, he's clearly had this job for a while.
Yeah.
He shows up and it's kind of leaking through.
Now, you notice it says here, it says, then I was what? What does it say there? It says terrified.
Yeah.
Why is he terrified?
Well, I would guess because of the relationship with the king.
He's the king.
Yeah, he's a king. And not just a little king. I mean, this is a pretty big
king. Most powerful. Yeah.
Pretty big king.
He is, because the king can have other people. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So he says, I was terrified, but I replied, long live the king, which when you're talking to a king, great first line.
Yeah. Especially as the cupbearer. Right.
How can I not be sad? For the city where my ancestors are buried is in ruins and the gates have been destroyed by fire. Mm. There's been a recent setback.
Yeah.
People have been sent back to rebuild. They thought it was being done. I mean, there's been a recent, and this devastates them. Look at the fourth verse.
The king asks, well, how can I help you?
So when he woke up there that day, did he think, you know what, here's what's going to happen.
Yeah.
The most powerful person in the world or my world is going to look at me and say, you know what,
how can I help?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
That line, how can I help? First of all, I just talked to the people out there. In your marriage, if you're married and it's not doing well, maybe the question that needs to become part of the culture of your marriage is people saying, hey, how can I help?
Wow.
Like you wake up thinking,
how can I help?
How can I serve you today?
Wow. With your kids.
What are you thinking about? Family. Is it going to get better or worse if that's the attitude?
Yeah.
Can you imagine a kid saying, hey, mom, how can I help?
No, that trajectory over kids' life, you're like, that is the stuff.
I know you're my younger brother, but man, how can I help? Can I help?
In our jobs.
Every organization will be better if that's the attitude. Most of the organizations, the attitude is not, how can I help?
Yeah. No, or the expectation is like for a Nehemiah, somebody who's lower down to ask that question, but never for the person in power or a position above to actually reciprocate with how can I help?
Yeah, yeah. So notice where it says with a prayer to the God of heaven. So he does a short prayer here. Nehemiah, Artaxerxes probably doesn't even know.
Yeah.
Okay, these are called, I heard someone call them arrow prayers. It's where you grab a arrow out of your quiver and you just...
You got a second, you just fire it up.
So you fire it up to God.
Yeah. But he had a habit, a rhythm in his life of prayer.
He's like, Jesus, right now, say something good through me.
Yep. Okay.
Right? You can do that.
And then he replied, if it pleases the king and if you are pleased with me, your servant, send me to Judah to rebuild the city where my ancestors are buried. So clearly he had something in his heart.
He was ready.
Yeah.
He knew what he was going to ask for. Yep. And the king's with the queen, and they look at him, and they're like, okay, they don't just say yes. They don't say no. They're like, well, how long are you going to be away? And doesn't, you know, Nehemiah
was like... As a supervisor, it's a good question.
They're going to ask you that. And so then they agree to your quest. But then it says, look at verse 7. It says,
I also said to the king.
What if he didn't say that? Hmm. A lot of us are like, you see brokenness, you have a vision, and you're trying to do it, and you're overwhelmed.
Yeah.
And you give up. And the reason why, you don't have teammates.
No.
And you actually don't really have the resources.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe we moved ahead of God on that.
Wow. Instead of just asking, he goes one step further.
Yeah, he says, hey, if it pleases the king. And he asks really for three things here. He says, okay, one thing, I'm going to need to pay time away. Mm-hmm. I'm going to need some resources, timber.
Yep.
And I'm going to actually need some safe travel.
The letter's address to be able to travel safely.
I'm going to need an armed escort. If I have a, think about it, I've got a bunch of resources and I'm traveling 800 miles. Yeah. So if you're in Seattle, you're going from Seattle to San Francisco.
Wow.
Someone might.
Wow. To rebuild a city.
Rip this stuff off.
Yeah.
Like, oh, a bunch of timber. We'll just take you down. No. So now he's got an armed escort from the empire of their day. So no one's stealing this stuff.
No. Okay. But also, these are big asks. I mean, this isn't just like, hey, can I go? Mm-hmm. Now you've actually asked for the resources of the king.
And it says there that the king granted these requests because of why? The gracious hand of God is on me.
Yeah.
I think we've got to trust that, I think in some ways, do things in ways that you can't take credit. It's, we say, only by the grace of God.
It's a miracle.
Yeah. Yeah. And so they get there, they show up, they deliver, you got all this stuff. And it says when they get there, everyone's excited. No. Look at verse 10. Sanballat.
Wow.
Tobiah.
Yep.
They hear of his arrival, and they're what? These are officials.
The officials,
leaders.
Yeah.
Very displeased that someone had come to help. Okay, so think about that. So when you start asking, how can I help? Just expect there's going to be some people who actually they're working against
you. Opposed to.
Yeah, they don't want the cities to be beautiful and better.
Yeah. Which, by the way, for my own heart, someone's going to ask someone's going to be available. God's going to speak to somebody. And it may be outside the circle I've drawn of who can help.
Well, think about Artaxerxes. It was like, hey, let me just go find the most spiritually connected to Jesus person I can find. No, like Artaxerxes, like who knows where his belief system
is. Sure. And he is the government. I mean, he is like the top of the power.
Yeah, yeah. But I do see here that Nehemiah is ready to answer the question, how can I help? Hmm. I was thinking about Brian to a time early on, we'd launched this church. We were meeting in a school. Mm-hmm. We were setting up and tearing down. Mm-hmm. Okay, we did that for years. Somebody actually took me on a ride. They said, get in the car, get in a truck. So we got in a truck, we drove around. Mm. And we started driving by stuff. And he said, tell me what you see. Like, what do you need? Like,
for the city.
How can I help?
Yeah.
How can I help?
Yeah.
Like, do you want to build a church facility? Like, do you need some land? Do you need some?
Wow. Somebody who had the resources and power to be able to do that.
Yeah.
How'd you respond?
Well, I wasn't ready for the question.
Yeah.
I don't
expect to get in someone's car and have them basically offer the world.
I kind of thought that the church is really, it's really, we have the resources that I can come up with.
Yeah.
We have our leadership lid is going to be me. Hmm. And that's a problem.
Yeah.
If we think we're the answer, we're the solution, we're the resource, and so, when you do that, you're not dreaming. You're not ready for that kind of question.
No.
So I literally said, we drove around for a couple hours. And at the end of it, I just said, I just don't know. I said, I'll have to get back to you.
Hmm.
Which 15 years later, that hasn't happened yet. Next time.
Yeah. Next time. Yeah,
exactly. Can you imagine if the king says to Nehemiah, how can I help? And Nehemiah says, I'm going to have to get back to you on that.
Yeah.
Like, right?
That was the moment.
Think about it. Like, right now, there's somebody that God's brought into your life that you already know that wants to help you do the God-given purpose that God has for your life.
A massive vision, massive dreams.
And when they say, how can I help? You say, I have to get back to you.
But Nehemiah is not only ready, but he knows the specific ask. And that points back, just think about, to the journal. Mm-hmm. He's prepared this in his heart. So when we start to get this in our heart, we have like, it's almost like an elevator pitch.
The reason why I wasn't ready to answer that question is I hadn't been keeping a journal.
Yeah. So then how do we get ready to, so what stuff is it? Like, this is how we get ready to, you know, someone's going to ask us, how do we get our hearts ready? Because it feels like the journal and starting to like allow God to speak in that way. But what's like really practical?
Well, okay, so one of the things that has to happen is before you get your speech ready, God has to get your heart ready.
Okay.
Okay? So there's a process in chapter one where he's mourning.
Yeah.
He fasts.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of us skip over the very last words of chapter one. Do you have them there in front of you? Hmm. It's the last sentence of chapter one of Nehemiah, and it says, I have it here so you don't have to worry, look for it. It says, in those days, I was the king's cupbearer. So in those days, I believe this. One of the things that you have to do to get ready is you have to know this. You're going to have to give something up.
Wow.
To do something that God's going to ask you to do. It's not like Jesus said, hey, come follow me and you don't have to lose anything. He's like, no, you.
There will be a cost.
They laid down their nets.
Yeah.
There's something that you leave behind. And so for Nehemiah, he had to leave this behind, being the cupbearer. He had to leave behind a comfortable job.
Really comfortable.
Great benefits.
Potential identity to, you know, I'm the cupbearer.
Well, think about it. If your job was, I'm an assistant to the most powerful person in the world.
Yeah.
Okay. Like, so he's going to give that up.
Yeah.
And the reason why I bring this up is there's something, Brian, that's called role identity.
Hmm.
And that's where you're so good at something, your role becomes also what you're known for.
Mm-hmm.
So probably in that day, people see Nehemiah and they'd be like, oh, there's Nehemiah. And the next person was cupbearer. Yeah,
cupbearer.
He's cupbearer. Yeah, he's cupbearer.
That's cupbearer.
Yeah, he's going to have to give that up.
Wow.
Oh, there's Wes. That's the, you know, this whatever it was. For me, I remember one point I was so into being a youth pastor that when I had to give that up, I cried, but not a good one.
Because that was. No, we all feel that.
Because it was my identity.
Because of the identity. Yeah.
Yeah, because you feel like when you lose your role, you've lost you.
And in some ways, God doesn't strip anything away. He just gives you more.
Yeah, now, so think about this. So he's going to have to give up what he's been known for, and he's going to be heading off. And I was thinking about you. Did you grow up watching Star Wars at all?
Yeah, love Star Wars.
Okay. And so in Star Wars, I think about a couple characters. Okay, there's Han Solo, and there's Luke Skywalker.
Yep.
Okay. So we do a little quiz here. Okay. So the actor who played Han Solo is
Harrison Ford. Harrison Ford.
And then the actor who played Luke Skywalker is
Luke Skywalker. Mark Hamill.
Yeah. Not everyone knows that.
Mark Hamill. But it did take me a second.
I'm telling you, Harrison Ford will walk onto a screen as Han Solo, and people are like, Han Solo, Harrison Ford? Yeah, because Indiana Jones. He's into Tom Clancy things. But when Luke Skywalker comes out there, people are just, that's Luke Skywalker.
Yeah.
Mark Hamill, probably the rest of his life, went to the grocery store and they're like, hey,
Luke Skywalker.
Okay. And so what happened is his role became his identity.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Listen, I had a woman send me, an older woman was working a job. She got injured and she couldn't do her job anymore. And she felt like she had lost her identity. And we had a moment as a pastor where I was able to help her understand your identity does not come from who you are.
Yeah.
Your identity comes from who you belong to.
Yeah.
You belong to God.
And those peeling back those layers. That's really good. Okay. Well, what else?
Okay. Well, I think a second thing of getting ready is this is, you have to know this. It's going to be the people that you serve. It's the people that you help that are going to help you with your vision.
Mm-hmm.
So I think one of the things to start to do right now to get ready is to make a part of your life this question, how can I help?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I jump to another story. Joseph had a dream in the Bible in Genesis. He ends up becoming the second most powerful person in the world to the Pharaoh, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But before he could have his dream come true, what did he have to learn? how to help other people with their dreams.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so there's this.
He made it all about himself in some ways, yeah.
So God, we want to become leaders. God wants us to become helpers. Think about that. Okay, so you have Adam. He's in the garden, and God says it's good. It's not good. For man to be alone.
Yeah, for you to be by yourself.
This is not good. None of us make great decisions when we are living in isolation. So he says, I'm going to make for you what? A
helper.
Now, for years, people say like, okay, helper is a weak word. You know, that's the woman, you know. Sure. Carrie's my helper, right? That's my wife.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, that's because that's it. No. Okay. I want you to think about this. The word helper, okay, ezer, or, you know, it's used about, okay, well, I won't go there yet, is the word helper. It's used 66 times in the Bible.
Wow.
About one person. God.
Wow.
It's like, God's like, here's how I want you to know I'm all powerful.
Yeah.
I'm so powerful, I am what? Eleazar.
Wow.
The Lord is my helper.
The Lord is my helper.
So the thing about, we want to get away from being a helper.
Yeah.
Because I want to be a leader. And God's like, well.
I want to go up.
No. Here's how you become. You become a helper. So there's no way, because here's why. If you don't become a helper, what you end up doing is going to be all about you.
Yes.
Centered
yes.
on you.
Yes.
We're not trying to make the city beautiful. No. I'm making myself look beautiful so you can worship me.
Yeah.
So you've got to learn how to become a helper. Nehemiah had spent his life serving the king. So of course the king said, How can I help? Yep.
So we're going to give something up.
Okay.
We're going to be able to have this really beautiful vision of collaboration. And then what else?
Well, I think finally is you don't leave, you get sent. So think about this. He says, if it pleases the king, send me. Right now we have people leaving jobs, leaving churches, leaving states. Listen, all of us are going to move. Relocate, get a different job. I understand it. Honestly, we have a God who's on the move. God calls people to move.
Yes.
But when we leave, what happens is this, is it actually disconnects us even more.
Relational gap. Wow.
When you get sent, then all of a sudden, everybody in your life gets to stay connected and be a part of your story.
Yeah. So good. It's so good because then it's an ability that you'll have over the course of, I mean, you look at Nehemiah's life, he was actually rebuilding a network, community.
Imagine Artaxerxes, people were like saying, hey, where's Nehemiah? And he's like, well, he's in Jerusalem. Guess what we're doing?
Yeah.
We're rebuilding the walls.
Yeah.
So Artaxerxes got to say the word, we.
Wow. And we don't even know his beliefs, his backstory. I mean, this is like so far out potentially of somebody that would be included in God's story. God seems to still.
There's in our life. Our problems in the world or in our community, are they small or big?
Big.
They're so big. Yeah, okay. Big. We need a bigger team.
Yep.
Okay. You're not going to get a bigger team by leaving all of your friendships all the time.
Yeah. By the way, you're like hearing that. You're like, man, I don't even, how would I get those people? How would I have a team? So that's next week. A couple things I wrote down. One, I just think, let's keep a journal. That's the action I feel just personally. Second is we're going to be someone who asks how we can help. And then I did write this as almost a PS. Is just like, if you're thinking that thing for teenagers, I want to be involved in that.
Yeah.
So by the way, we have summer camps this summer. That might be something you give to, you serve at, or you might just start ask God, okay, how can I serve the schools? How can I serve teenagers? I love it. Thank you so much for your heart. Love where you live. I just want to pray us out. Jesus, thank you for the good work you're doing in us and around the world. Connect us to your good news of your gospel through asking how we can help. Get us dedicated, God, that we can be focused in the way we journal, we write down some thoughts, get that habit inside of us so that we can see a great move in our city, in our communities, in our states, our country, and our world. We pray this in your name, Jesus.
And I search the world. Sing it together. Oh, there's nothing.
better than better.